Hare Krishna, Vachan, Bhavani Vaishnavi. Just a minute. Okay, just a minute. What is this? Time to practice. Okay, I have it. Okay, 385. That is what you're. All right, let's resume. Ajo janma bhinopi jato janma viracharat. He is aja, or he who is never born. Nonetheless, for his appearance, he acts out of outer display, he acts out a display of his birth. Now, this is brought out both in the Shruti scriptures and in the Smriti scriptures. Ajayamano bahudha vijayate tasya dhira parijananti yonim. Without taking birth, he is born in many forms. The wise understand the source of his appearance. Ajobi sannage atma bhutam ishwaropi sann prakritim swam adhishthaya sambhavami atma mayaya. Although I am unborn, and my transcendental body never deteriorates, and although I am the Lord of all living entities, by my eternal energy, I still appear in every millennium in my original transcendental form. That's just a sample. There are other statements from the Smriti scriptures. Manvetasya kila ajatvam janitvam cha virdhyate ityashankyaha bhagavan achintyeshwarya vaibhavaha. One main question. But is it not contradictory for one who is unborn to take birth? In reply, the personality of Godhead has inconceivable power and opulence. When the unborn makes his appearance, he does not take birth. but appears as Vishnu does before Gajendra and Dhruva, without any connection with the mother and father. Why then are some of his incarnations said to have parents? Tatra tatra yatavah stejo rupena sannapi jayate manikashthadeer hetum kanchit davapyasa anadim meva janmadi lilant eva tathat bhutam hetuna kenachit krishna pradushkuryat kadachana. Fire's luminous essence is present in various objects such as flintstones and the kindling wood used to ignite sacrificial fires. But the fire becomes manifest only with the application of appropriate agents. Similarly, Krishna's amazing birth and other pastimes are beginningless, but they are revealed only at certain times when there is a suitable cause. So here, the idea is that fire is dormant in various objects. So in that sense, fire is always there. But fire also appears in the form of flame. You apply certain agents, perform certain activities, that fire appears in the form of a flame. So like that, the Supreme Lord is always there, dormant, even in particular forms. But he uses certain nimitta, certain pretexts, certain reasons, and through those reasons he appears in those forms. Because the Supreme Lord and his identity, qualities, powers, and personality are absolutely indestructible, he's never compelled to take birth by coming into contact with the elements of a created body. Nonetheless, by his inconceivable energies, he appears in this world as the moon appears on the eastern horizon. Swarupa guna vibhuti shileshu vikara leshat tavad ajatvam. He is untransformed even slightly, even during his, in terms of his personalities, attributes, opulences, and character. Dhatu yogam vinayiva prachyam indoriva tad dehe avirbhavat janmitvam. So he is said to be aja, unborn, because he is untransformed in all of his different forms, with their respective, with each form having a respective set of features, opulences, and characters. So therefore, in that sense, he is aja, unborn. Now, that requires some thought to understand. In this life, I'm born as a human being, Indian, male, corresponding to my punya and papa that I executed this life, and of course, worked out overall based on my previous accumulation of punya and papa, pious and impious activities. Based on that, rather reactions to my pious and impious activities, I'll be given another birth in my next life. And at that time, my form will be different. My set of features would be different. My powers would be different. My characters would be different. In every lifetime, it will be different. And in each lifetime, my body will undergo 6 transformations. So, because Krishna does not undergo any of these, he is unborn. In all of his forms, unborn, in the literal sense. Because he never experiences birth the way we experience. At the same time, he does take birth, but there are certain peculiar features. He appears in particular forms through the bodies of particular persons, just as the moon appears in the east without when we say the moon appears in the east, it is just according to our vision that the moon appears in the east. It's not a literal fact. So similarly, the Supreme Lord, he takes birth without any seminal discharge and so on. Nonetheless, by his inconceivable energies, he appears in this world as the moon appears on the eastern horizon. Fire is present in its potential form in many objects, but it becomes manifest only under certain circumstances, such as when one stone is struck by another to produce sparks that then come in contact with something flammable, or when sacrificial kindling wood is ignited by friction. Similarly, the personality of Godhead's pastime of taking birth is eternal, but it is manifest in the material cosmos only on certain occasions, such as at the completion of the 28th Dwapar Yuga of the Vaivasvata Manvantara. That's the Shantolita theory. And other similar theories about Krishna's appearing temporarily have no basis in fact. Iti achintya aishwaryat idam sarvam bhavati iti akachya chankha iti arthaha. This is all by his inconceivable opulences. So there is no need to be frightened. Itam cha shanto ditat voktir dura pasta. So therefore, this idea that he only appears temporarily here, that has been rejected. So lila kirti vistara loki shvanu jikrit shuta asya janmag lila na prakatya hetu tamaha. The most important cause of Krishna's revealing his birth and other activities is his desire to be merciful to the people of the world by spreading the fame of his pastime. Tatha bhayankaratarai pityamaneshu danavai priyeshu karunapyatra hetur vityuktamevahi. It is also said that when horrible demons oppress those dear to him, his compassion for his devotees causes him to appear. Why did Krishna descend to the earth? He came first of all to reclaim the aspiring devotees who are awaiting his mercy. Removing the earth's burden of unruly kings was not the main purpose of Krishna's avatar. He easily could have accomplished that through empowered jivas, as shown, for example, in the Puranic descriptions of Parashara and Dhruva killing many rakshasas. Rather, Krishna was motivated by his compassionate desire to relieve the anxiety of his satakra devotees like Shrutadeva and Bahulashwar, who were incessantly thinking about his beautiful form and divine qualities, and who were extremely anxious to see him in person. Furthermore, Krishna had sent many of his most beloved devotees to the earth before him, including his parents Vasudeva and Devaki. They were being harassed by Kamsa and other enemies. Krishna wanted to show his affection for these devotees and destroy the demons disturbing them. Why does Swayam Bhagavan appear? That is for the benefit of the sadhakas. We have read all of this. It is for the sake of his sadhaka devotees who are absorbed in his forms and qualities. They are hankering for directly meeting him. To give them bliss. Bhumi bhara bhaaraya brahmadye tridasheshvarai abhyarthanam tu yattasya tadbhavedanushangikam. The entreaty from Brahma and other chief demigods for the Lord to relieve the earth burden is only a circumstantial cause of his appearance. चेतद्यादृक्षेरम उत्कंठार्ता निज प्रिया ताम ताम लीलाम ततः कृष्ण दर्शये तान कृपा निधि. इवन नाउ इफ कृष्णस डिवोटीज, if Krishna's beloved devotees develop sufficient eagerness, that ocean of mercy reveals his various pastimes to them. Kairapi prema vai vashya bhagvir bhagavatottamai adhyapi drishyate Krishna kridan vrindavan antare. Some exalted devotees overcome by the power of pure love can see Krishna playing in Vrindavan even today. Pure Vaishnavas could not witness Krishna's pastimes unless those pastimes were actual and ongoing. Here is more evidence that Krishna's Leela is eternal. Srila Rupa Goswami will now explain this directly. He had stated Krishna's birth and other pastimes, they are without beginning. Now he establishes this. It is not possible to see that which is non-existent. Therefore, it should be understood that his birth and other activities, they are real. Rupa Goswami will clarify this. Kim chasya parshadadi nam apyukta nitya murtita tasyeshvare shittur nityam murtitve kavichitrata. The forms of Krishna's companions and other associates are also said to be eternal. What wonder then if the personal form of Him who is the Supreme Lord of all lords is eternal? The reason tells us that Krishna's pastimes can continue eternally only if He who displays those pastimes lives eternally. The personality of Godhead is described in more than one Upanishad as the one eternal conscious being. Among many eternal conscious beings, who supplies the needs of all of them? So you have one eternal conscious being. There are other many eternal conscious beings. And the one, he supplies the needs of the rest. Famous statement. Nityo nityanam chetanas chetanam eko bahunam yo vidadhati kama. These words are also found in the Gopala Tapani Upanishad, where they are elaborated upon with special reference to Sri Krishna. Eko vashi sarvagah Krishna indhya eko visan bahudha yoga bhati tampitastam yenu bhajanti dhirastesham sukham shashvatam netaresham nityo nityanam chetanas chetananam eko bahunam yo vidadhati kama tampitagam yenu yajanti vipras tesham sinti shashvati netaresham. Krishna alone is the supreme controller, the all-pervading worshipable Lord. Although one, he appears as many. The wise who worship him properly on his royal throne achieve eternal happiness, but not others. That one eternal conscious being among many eternal conscious beings supplies the needs of all others. Again, the wise who worship him properly on his royal throne achieve eternal perfection, but not others. In a previous verse, the Gopala Tapani describes Krishna as Gopa Gopi Kavav Vitam, surrounded by cowherd boys, cowherd girls, and cows. These associates are the many eternal conscious beings whose needs he fulfills. He supplies, fulfilling all their desires. So now, this is an Upanishad. Upanishad texts are as they are. There is a distinction between the Shruti and the Smriti. Shruti scriptures and Smriti scriptures. Shruti scriptures, and we have the Smriti scriptures. Shruti scriptures refer to the four Vedas. And here, Varna and Krama are, I'll explain what it means. This comes in Tattva Sandarbha and Sarva Samvadini to Tattva Sandarbha, Jiva Goswami. Here, the Varna and Krama are not in. No, let me put it like this. Varna Krama is in. Varna Krama is in. Here, the Varna Krama is not. Okay. take something like issue operation as an example. I'll show you. Isha Upanishad is an Upanishad. This Upanishad's name is Isha because it begins with the word with Isha, Ishavasyam. Ishavasyam. Now, this is a mantra. And this mantra has a sequence of letters. E is one letter. And that S with the dash above. In Jiva Goswami's grammar, we call it Sharana. It's the letter Sha. And then you have the vowel short A. So these are, each one is called a Varna. And so you have here a series of letters. E, Sha, A, Va, A, Sa, Ya, A, Ma, E, Da. A, Ma, Sa, A, Ra, Va, A, Anuswara, and so on. Now, here the sequence of these varnas, these letters, is intact in the Shruti. That means Ishopanishad will always have mantras like this. ईशावास्यम इदं सर्वं यत्किंच जगत्याम जगत्तेन तत्तेन भुञ्जीथा महाग्रदस्य स्विद्धनम विल ऑलवेज बी लाइक दिस इट विल नेवर एवर बी रीवर्डेड इन एनी डे ऑफ ब्रह्मा इन एनी यूनिवर्स एट एनी पॉइंट इन टाइम दिस मंत्र विल ऑलवेज बी दिस मंत्र इफ यू लुक एट द सेकंड मंत्र कुर्वन्नेव कर्माणि जीविशेषतम समाह एवं त्वयि नान्यते तोस्ति न कर्म लिप्यते नरे. This mantra will always be like this. Never ever it will change. Now you may wonder, what's the big thing about that? I'll take as a contrast, a Smriti text. Bhagavad Gita. Anashrita karma palam karyam karma karotiya sa sanyasi cha yogi cha na niragnir na chakriya. Here also you have a sequence of varnas, letters. But in the Bhagavad Gita that Krishna will speak in the future or in the past, he does not have to preserve the sequence of syllables. He can change it as he likes. In the Smriti scriptures, these things happen. He can reword it entirely. He can just recompose this entire verse with totally a different set of synonyms and just different, conveying the same concept. First of all, he doesn't even have to have a Bhagavad Gita in 18 chapters. He chose to do it in 14 chapters or 20 chapters, whatever. Smriti is like that. In Smriti, the concept is intact, but the exact sequence of syllables is not intact. In Shruti, the concept is intact and the very sequence of syllables is intact. It is like Shruti, I'll compare it to audio. I will say it is audio. It's like you hear about songs, you know. In the Western world, they give awards for particular albums and songs. Now, what is a song? A song contains a lyric, it contains some background music, but it is sung in a particular manner. That whole thing put together gives you the identity of a song. You cannot reword the text. You cannot change the music. You cannot sing it in a different manner. Then immediately it's no longer the same song. Smriti, I'll compare it to a text. A novel. Or the storyline, rather, not even a novel, storyline. The storyline could be expressed in various ways, actually. You may express the storyline through a novel, or you may express the storyline through a movie, through a TV series, through a radio drama, through a dance drama in the street. So many ways you can express the story. Shruti is like that. Shruti is audio. Shruti itself means that which is meant to be heard, is audio. So the sequence of syllables is intact. Now, the next question may be, so what? Well, if the varnakrama or sequence of syllables is intact, it has profound implications. It means that everything that is brought out in the Shruti deals with eternal subjects and eternal phenomena. So here, when we look at the Gopala Tapani. Okay. So here, Krishna is described as Gopa Gopi Gavavitam. Gopala is surrounded by cowherd boys, cowherd girls, and cows. And first of all, it means that this Gopala in Vrindavana is eternal. He has a name, Krishna. And he is always surrounded by gopas, gopis, and cows. They are also eternal. Otherwise, the Shruti wouldn't be able to speak like this. That too, while describing him in how he exists in his own place. These associates are the many eternal conscious beings whose needs he supplies, fulfilling all their desires. Okay. Tathapi shushkavad ekanishthanam hetuvadinam tushnim bhavaya vachanam puranadeh vilikhyate. Nonetheless, to silence the skeptics attached to dry theories, I will record here some statements from the Puranas and other scriptures. So now, there's a standard injunction given by Manu in Manu Samhita. Itihasa Puranabhyam Vedam Sam Upabrahmaye. One should develop a clear understanding. One should amplify one's understanding of Shruti. One should clarify one's understanding of Shruti with the help of the Itihasas and the Puranas. Smriti. Shruti has to be understood through spotless Smriti. So, even though it's already referred to Gopala Tapani, nevertheless, to make things really clear, Sri Rupa Goswami is now going to present evidence from the Smriti literature. Tatha hi Sri Bhagavate Brahmastutau Vayeva Nitya Sukha Bhoda Tanavanante Mayata Ujjyatati Yat Sad Ivava Bhati. For example, in Srimad Bhagavatam, in the prayers offered by Lord Brahma, this universe appears independent because it is manifested from the illusory potency that emanates from you, who have unlimited transcendental forms, full of eternal happiness and knowledge. Everything the Supreme Lord creates, including this limited world, can be called Sat in the sense of real, but not Sat in the sense of independent. As stated in the Mahabharata, Satvam Svatantriyam Uddishtam Tatcha Krishne Nachapare Aswatantriya Tadanye Shamasatvam Vidhi Bharata. Sat means independence. This is found in Krishna and no one else. You should understand everything else as Asat, O Bharata, simply because it has no independence. So this world exists as if it is independent. Sri Brahmandecha. Anadeya Maheyam Cha Bhutam Bhagavato Hare Avirbhava Tirobhava Vasyokte Grahamo Channe. And in Sri Brahmanda Purana, although we may refer to his appearance and disappearance as accepting and giving up a body, the personality of God and Hari never assumes or abandons his bodily form. So it's only an idiom. It's due to an idiomatic usage. We talk like this. Sri Brihad Vaishnave Nityavataro Bhagavan Nityam Murtir Jagat Patihi Nitya Rupo Nitya Gandho Nitya Ishwarya Sukhanu Bhu. In the Brihad Vishnu Puran, the personality of Godhead, the Lord of the universe, has eternal incarnations, eternal forms, eternal beauty, eternal fragrance, eternal power, and an eternal experience of bliss. One might ask that if Lord Hari is eternal, why does the scriptures describe him as accepting and giving up particular bodies? For example, Jagrihe Pavusham Rupam, he accepted the form of the Purusham. And Harirapi Tatyaja Akritya Dhishaha. Hari, Lord of the three worlds, give up that form. This doubt is resolved when we understand that his avatars are also eternal. The Lord exhibits and hides his various personal forms as his pastime. So his exhibition has to be described through some language, through the usage of some words. And his hiding his various personal forms from the vision of the conditioned souls also has to be described. So therefore, there is that expression. He's accepted a body. He has given up a body. Padme Shri Vyasambarisha Samvade Shri Krishnam Prati Shri Vyasa Vachana Vamaham Drashtumichami Chakshurbhyam Madhusudana Yattat Satyam Param Brahma Jagadyonam Jagadpatim Vadanti Vedashyarasas Chakshusham Nathamestu Tat. The Padma Purana, Shri Vyasa recalls to Ambarish words Vyasa had spoken during a dialogue with Shri Krishna. I wish to see you, O Madhusudana. May that Supreme Absolute Truth, whom the Upanishads describe as the origin and master of the universe, be visible to my eyes. Shri Krishna Vakyam. Pashyattvam darshayishyami swarupam veda gopitam tato pashyam aham bhuva balam kalambuda prabham gopakanya vratam gopam hasantam gopabalakai kadambamula asinam vita vasasamachutam. Shri Krishna replied, watch, I will show you my true form, which the Vedas keep secret. I then saw a boy, O king, whose luster was like that of a dark cloud. He was a cowherd, sitting at the base of a kadamba tree, surrounded by cowherd maidens and joking with other cowherd boys, dressed in yellow. He was the infallible Lord. Sounds right there from Padma Purana. Tatraivagre, tato mamaha bhagavan vrindavanacharasmayan. Yadidam mit vayadrishtam rupam divyam sanatanam nishkalam nishkriyam shantam sachidananda vigraham purnam padmam palashaksham natah parataram mama. Further on in the same passage, then that personality of God who moves about the Vrindavan forest smiled and addressed me. This divine form of mine you now see is eternal, indivisible, without material activities and peaceful. It is a perfectly complete personal form of eternity, knowledge, and bliss with the lotus petal eyes. I have no form greater than this. Idam eva vadantyete vedakarana karanam satyam vyapi paranandam chidghanam shashvatam shivam. It is this form that the Vedas describe as the cause of all causes, as the all-pervasive truth, as the supreme bliss, as the embodiment of pure spirit, and as perpetual and all auspicious. Sabhashadasya Krishnasya Nityam Murtita Sputayati. He now presents very clear evidence that Krishna, along with his associates, all have eternal forms. Swayam Rupasya Purana Tamatvam. Etat Veshasya, Etat Parikarasya, Etat Leelasya Chaiti Bhavam. Look at this form. It is me in my Swayam Rupa. Most complete. Vasudeva Upanishad. Madrupa Madvayam Brahma Madhyadyantam Vivarjitam Swaprabham Sachidanandam Bhaktyajanati Chadvayamiti. And in Sri Vasudeva Upanishad, my form is the absolute truth. beyond duality. It has no beginning, middle, or end. Self-effulgent and incorruptible. It is made of eternity, knowledge, and bliss. One understands this form through devotional service. As these and other scriptural statements explicitly establish, the personal forms of Krishna and his companions are all eternal. Krishna's essential self is perfect and complete, and his attire, his dress, entourage, his associates, and sporting activities are also perfect and complete. Krishna's transcendental body is the absolute truth, Brahman, because there is never any trace of duality between him and his body. Nanga rupa swatah krishno drishyo maika rupatah. Someone may propose, but Krishna is innately formless by himself, rather by itself. Krishna must be formless. He conjures a form when he wants to become visible. So he may come up with a form whenever he wants to become visible. So that concept might be presented. Using the rhetorical principle, Suna Nikhata, planting the pillar deeper, Chila Rupa establishes the eternality of Krishna's personality even more solidly by considering another argument of the Mayavadis. The impersonalists argue that Krishna has pure consciousness and bliss, has no visible form. They say that he comes into view by assuming bodies made from Vishuddha Sattva, which they consider the unmixed material mode of goodness. A number of statements from the Puranas and epics seem to corroborate this theory. Tatathahi mokshat dharme shri bhagavat vachanam yatha. Etatvayan vigyayam rupavaniti drishyate ichchan muhurtam ashyayam ishokam yatatam guru. Thus the Lord makes this statement in the moksha dharma. Although you see me like this, you should not assume that I inhabit a form. If I desired, I could dissolve it in a single moment. After all, I am the Supreme Lord and the spiritual master of all the worlds. So that's a statement from the Moksha Dharma. The impersonalists foolishly interpret these words to mean, please do not think that I, the Supreme Lord, am visible because I am restrictively embodied like others. If I want, I can easily abandon this physical form, reverting again to invisibility. I can easily assume and withdraw forms as I like, even though no one else enjoys the same liberty. Maya Shesha Maya Srishta Yanma Pashyasi Narada Sarvabhuta Gunair Yuktam Naivam Tvam Yatumarhasi Iti. What you see is the Maya I have created, Narada. You should not think that I am really connected to the elements of creation. A person might ask the Lord, if you are essentially formless, how do you assume forms? In the Mayavadi's view, Krishna answers, my forms are products of Maya. Do not think that I, the formless essence of knowledge and bliss, mixed with the five material elements that begin with sound. Athacha, Padme, Nama Rupa Evayam, Bhagavan Hari Ishvara, Akarte Ticha Yoga Nei, Smriti Vrishcha Vidhiyate Iti. And in the Padma Purana, the personality of God and Lord Hari has no name or form. The Vedas and Smritis designate him as inactive. Atra Samadhanam Yathashri Vasudeva Adhyatme. Now this has been resolved. Sri Vasudeva Adhyatma. Aprasiddhestarbunanam anamasa pratirtitaha aprakritatvad rupasya pyarupo sa udiriyate sambandhena prathanasya harenasteva kartritta akartara matahprahu puranam tam puram vidahatiti. These points are resolved as follows in Sri Vasudeva Adhyatma. Because Lord Hari's qualities are not completely known, he is called nameless. Because his form is not material, he is called formless. And because he is not connected with material nature, that ancient Lord is called inactive by the wise ancients who know him. Nirasyati. So, by quoting from Vasudeva Adhyatma, he now refutes this misconception. Kārṣṇeya avācyatvād iti arthaḥ. Because he cannot be described completely. He is said to be indescribable. The scriptural evidence cited above is authoritative, but one is obliged to understand it correctly. The Supreme Lord is nameless in the sense that no one is able to describe everything about him. Kārṣṇeya na yogya bhidhātum īśaḥ. Even unborn Brahma is unable to name all his qualities. Even unborn Brahma is incapable of completely describing him. Formless should be understood to mean without material form. And inactive means that unlike the conditioned souls, the Lord does not have to act under the sway of material nature. He is active, but on his own initiative. Tadaikshata, he glanced. So kāyata, he desired. Lord Vishnu is glancing and is desiring to create our actions undertaken before he awakened this prakriti. Whether in creating the material world or in loving dealings with his pure devotees, the personality of Godhead always acts with absolute freedom. So now, Lord Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu has drawn our attention to this fact that the Supreme Lord glanced before prakriti was awakened. Prakriti is everything that's material. And Lord Vishnu's glancing at her indicates that he has the visual sense. He's capable of glancing. So he has visual sense. He's glancing at matter. All of matter put together. So that means his visual sense of sight, his ability to glance and so on, has nothing to do with anything material. So kamayata, he desired. So that means he has a mind. Remember that in the Vedic system of Sankhya physics, you can say, you have different elements. You have the five gross elements. You have the five sense objects, sound, touch, form, taste, smell. You have the knowledge acquiring senses, Jnanendriyas, five of them. You have the Karmendriyas, five working senses. You have mind, manas. You have buddhi, intelligence. You have ahankar, false ego. You have time. So there are different elements. You can take time away, but the remaining certainly constitutes prakriti. But here we come across a situation where Lord Vishnu, he desires to create, and then he glances at prakriti, which is all of matter put together. So that means he has a mind which has nothing to do with anything material. This has already been illustrated in the passage cited from the Bhagavatam second canto describing Lord Brahma's vision of Vaikuntha. He has been described to be engaged in various sportive pastimes in a place which has absolutely no trace of matter. That has already been demonstrated in an earlier part of Laghu Bhagavatam by referring to the second canto of Bhagavatam. Atascha moksha dharmiya vachanam yogyameva tat. Thus, the statement of the moksha dharma is appropriately understood as follows. The reason the Supreme Lord has denied that he possesses a form is that he does not have to accept a body made of anything material. You should not think that as an ordinary person is visible because he has a form, the Supreme Lord becomes visible because he also inhabits the same kind of form. Thus, to disclose that his essential identity is not material, he describes himself as invisible even though he has his own form. तद्दर्शने त्वखुण्डात्मा अमेच्छैव च कारणम् इत्याहेच्छन् मुहूर्तादित्यर्थपद्यं स्वयं पुनः नश्येयम् इति अदृश्यस्यां यतो न नश्येर् अदर्शने. By the half verse beginning, if I desired in a moment, the Lord clarifies that the cause of this form's being seen is my desire, which is never frustrated. The verb nash, I could dissolve in this context, means I could become invisible. I could dissolve this form simply means I can make this, I can just make myself invisible. How can someone see the Supreme Person's transcendental form? By his merciful desire, his devotee can see him. But unless the Lord desires, no one can see him. Only when he chooses to smear the ointment of devotion on someone's eyes does his form become visible. You have foolishly misunderstood that Lord Hari as a form which is material. So now Rupa Goswami points out the actual meaning of those statements in the Moksha Dharma section, which was quoted. तथापि भूत गुणवत्त्वेन मां त्वं यदीक्षसे एषा माया मया सृष्टा नैवं त्वं ज्ञातुमर्हसि. If you still see my body as made of the element, as made of the qualities of material nature, that is an illusion I have created. You should not think of that perception as reality. The word maya can be applied to this verse as indicating the power of delusion. Maya tam hi kripayam cha. Maya means deceit and also mercy. That's the Vishwakosha dictionary. Maya syad chambari buddhyo. Maya is used to indicate sorcery and intelligence. Taking the word Maya's alternate meaning, mercy, the Lord is saying, you see my personal form by the transcendental power of my compassion. Maya shabdena kutrapi chitra vidhiyate. In some contexts, the word Maya indicates the Lord's spiritual energy. Chaturveda shikhaya swarupa bhutaya nitya shaktya maya khya maya khyaya yutaha ato maya mayam vishnu pravadanti sanatanam ityesha darshita madhva chari nirbhashye nijeshrutihi. In the Chaturveda shikha, the primeval Lord Vishnu is connected with the eternal energy of his essential being called Maya. Therefore, he is called Maya Maya, the one who is endowed with Maya. Maya is also a name of Lakshmi. It's originally a name of Lakshmi. Madhvacharya cited this Shruti text in his Vedanta Sutra commentary. The Supreme Lord can be said to be connected with Maya in still another sense. Maya is a name of his internal creative energy in the spiritual realm. The Mahasamhita uses this sense, atamaya tadichasya. His personal maya is his desire. In other words, taking this meaning, the Lord wants us to understand that he possesses a purely spiritual body, not a body produced of material elements. Maya vayunam jnanam iti nikantu upteshcha. It's not quoted here, but Sri Baladeva Dimushan Prabhu quotes from the nikantu that Maya also refers to knowledge. So you should understand that I have a form which is concentrated knowledge. You should not consider that I have a form which is made of material elements. तत्र स्वेच्छैक प्रकाशत्वं मोक्षधर्मेव प्रीतस्ततोस्य भगवान् देवदेव सनातन साक्षात्तम दर्शयामास सोदृश्यो येन केनचित्। In this regard, the Moksha Dharma explains how the Lord becomes manifest only by his own desire. When the personality of Godhead was pleased with him, that eternal Lord of Lords showed himself, although no one else could see him. This narration from the Moksha Dharma section of the Mahabharata's Shanti Parva describes what happened at a sacrifice performed by Upalichara Vasu, with the sage Brihaspati serving as the Advaryu priest. Satisfied with Upalichara Vasu's devotion, Lord Vishnu showed himself, but only to him. Brihaspati stata kruddha srucham udyamya vegitah akasham nan sruchah patai roshadashpunya vartaya. At that time, enraged Brihaspati impetuously raised the sruk ladle and struck at the air, shedding tears of anger. Udyata yanya bhaga hi sakshat prapta surayriha kimartham hana prapto harashanam saharir vibhu. The sacrificial offerings have been made and the demigods have directly received their portions. Why then has the Almighty Hari not made himself visible to us? Brihaspati had seen the demigods accept their offerings in person, but Lord Vishnu did not reveal himself to him. Frustrated, he struck at the air with the sacred ladle used for pouring ghee into the fire. Tatasatam samud bhutam bhumi palo maha vasupu prasadayamasa munim sadasyaste chasan vashaha. The great king Vasu then attempted to pacify the aroused sage. The Lord is indeed in our sacrificial assembly just as he is present everywhere. Aroshano hyasau devo yasya bhagoyam udyataha na shakya sa tvaya drashtum asmabhir va brihaspate yasya prasadam kurate savai tam drashtum arhati. The Supreme Lord, to whom you have presented his portion of the offerings, has no inclination towards anger. O Brihaspati, as you cannot see him, we also cannot see him. Only that person to whom he grants his favor can see him. Patraivyatadvitatritam vakyam atha vratasyava bhrate vag uvacha sharirini snigdha gambhiraya vacha bhrhatshyanakari vibho yuyam jinyasavo bhakta katham drakshyathatam vibhur. Also there we find the statement by ekata, dvita, and trita, their sages. And then as we took the avabhrata bath to complete our vow, a disembodied voice spoke in a sweet, grave voice, giving delight to the Supreme Lord. The voice said, "O inquisitive devotees, how can you expect to see him, the Almighty Lord?" The voice heard in the sky was that of Saraswati, the goddess of speech. Tatasvayam prakashatva shaktya svechha prakashaya sobhim yakto bhave netre na netra vishayatpataha. Thus, the Lord becomes visible to our eyes through his potency of self-manifestation by which he reveals himself according to his desire. He is never within the range of our eyes' perceptive power. The idea is that he cannot be perceived using our material eyes. When he allows himself to be seen, when he comes within the radar of our sense perception, then we can perceive him. Otherwise, we cannot perceive him. So this is the essence of this entire quotation from the Moksha Dharma section of Mahabharata about the Lord appearing and disappearing. In other words, when he wants, he shows himself. When he doesn't want, he doesn't show himself. Yatha Sri Narayanadhyatme Nitya Vyaktopi Bhagavan Ikshyate Nijashaktitaha Tamrute Paramatmanam Gah Pashyeta Mitam Prabhu. As stated in Sri Narayana Adhyatma, although the personality of Godhead is always imperceptible, one can see him by the agency of his personal potencies. Without the assistance of these potencies, who can see the Supreme Soul, the unlimited Lord? This confirms that the Supreme Lord reveals himself by his personal potency of compassion. So he utilizes his Karuna Shakti, Kripa Shakti, Nija Shakti Taha, Kripa Taha. Padme cha सच्चिदानंद रूपत्वात् स्याकृष्णो धोक्षज्योप्यसौ निज शक्ति प्रभावेन स्वं भक्तान् दर्शयत् प्रभुः. And in the Padma Purana, because his form is composed of eternity, knowledge and bliss, Krishna is adhokshaja, beyond the purview of the senses. But by the influence of his own potency, he reveals himself to his devotees. In relation to Krishna, the power of the eyes and other senses to perceive akshaja jnana becomes insignificant, adhakrita. He can be seen only by those with pure devotion. Therefore, Srila Rupa Goswami has mentioned in Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu, Atashri Krishna Namadi na bhavir grahya mindriyai. Therefore, Lord Krishna's name, form, quality, pastimes, abode, associates, none of these can be perceived by our senses. None of them can be grasped by our senses. Sevon mukhehi jihvadau swayameva spuratyada. However, when we become inclined to serve him, then he himself, by his own choice, without being forced, by his own choice, he manifests his name, form, qualities, pastimes, abode, and entourage, all by himself. Ya eva vigraho vyapi parichinna sevahi ekasyai kadachasya virupatvam virajate. His personal form is simultaneously all-pervading and limited in size. The one Lord appears in both these ways. Parelila anadika ityuktam nityasa iti vakshyate. Lord Hari's pastimes have no beginning. This has been stated. They are eternal. This will be stated. Tatraivam vivukashankha. Now, here is a doubt posed by a person who is averse to hearing this understanding. Parichinnasyaiva khalu lila. Only a person who is limited can engage in pastimes. Natu nabho nibhasya vibho sa asti. It's not possible for the Almighty, who is all-pervasive like the sky, to engage in pastimes, because how can you engage in pastime when you're all-pervasive everywhere, like the sky, or ether, explain it like this. Space. Space is everywhere. How space can engage in activity? Space is already everywhere. Yadyasya vachya tarhi tasya anityatva tat krita yas tasyascha tat asandeham iti chet. Now, how are you going to explain this? Lord Hari's pastimes are said to have no beginning or end. But a faithless person thinking that only someone limited by space and time can perform actions may doubt whether the all-pervading Supreme can have pastimes at all. And if we say that the Supreme is limited, wouldn't that mean he has a beginning and his activities also have a beginning? To resolve this doubt, one must understand that the Supreme Lord's acts are inconceivable. In one place, he can act as a small child for his mother's pleasure, and simultaneously, he can make himself accessible to the meditation of countless mystics throughout the universe. So he can be both. Yatha Shri Dashami Nachantar Nabahir Yasi Napurvam Napichapan Urva Param Bahishantar Jagato Yo Jagachaya Tamatvatmajam Vyaktam Matilingam Adhokshijam Gopiko Lu Khale Dam Nabamantha Prakratam Yatha. That's the 10th canto describes. The Supreme Personality of Godhead has no beginning and no end, no exterior and no interior, no front and no rear. In other words, he is all-pervading. Because he is not under the influence of the element of time, for him there is no difference between past, present, and future. He exists in his own transcendental form at all times, being absolute, beyond relativity. He is free from distinctions between cause and effect, although he is the cause and effect of everything. That unmanifested person who is beyond the perception of the senses and now appeared as a human child And Mother Yashoda, considering him her own ordinary child, bound him to the wooden mortar with a rope. Krishna has no special limits that could define his inside and outside. He simultaneously present at each and every corner of the cosmos. He resides within the living beings, within material nature, and within the universe as a whole. But one unpretentious cowherd woman of Braj, Yashoda, thinks of him as her son and punishes him for being naughty. As Queen Kunti remembers, Gopya Rade Tvayi Krita Rasida Matavad Yate Dashashvata Lilanjana Samramaksham Vaktram Niniya Priyabhavana Yastitasya Sama Vimohayati Veera Priyat Vidheti. My dear Krishna, the gopi took up a rope to bind you when you committed an offense, and your perturbed eyes all flooded with tears that washed the mascara from your eyes. And you were afraid, though fear personified is afraid of you. This sight is bewildering to me. This verse from the 10th canto describes Krishna, whom Mother Yashoda saw as her child, as Matyalinga. This verse from the 10th canto is the current verse that is being discussed in Laghuvavatamrita. Matyalinga, in the form of a human being. The Gopala Thapani Upanishad also describes him in human form. Vibhucham, Mauna Mudra, Dhyam. He has two arms, beautifully held in his gesture of quiet contemplation. He is adhokshaja, uninterested in ordinary sense pleasure, because he perpetually enjoys the pastimes that comprise his essential being. Yo jagata purvadishu desheshu yugapat vartate. Lord Krishna, he is simultaneously present in all the directions of the universe. Yascha kshetrajna prakriti man jagan mayas tam. And he is the possessor of all the kshetrajnas and prakriti. And this lady, Rajeshwari, the queen of Raja, this cowherd lady, she considered him to be her son. The other things are already brought up here. Okay. There is a question. Is the Rig Veda Shruti in English rendered in ISKCON? Shruti is said to be spoken by Shri Krishna. So we all are to read and understand, but some have reservations about reading Vedas. Why? Some academia even calls it primitive and full of karma kanda. What are the facts? Asya mahato bhutasya nishvasitam. The Supreme Lord has breathed out the Shruti, Smriti, and all of these scriptures. The distinction between Shruti and Smriti that I pointed out is a technical distinction, and that is referred to in Tattva Sandarbha, and it is understood amongst the Vedantists. It's understood, you know, among even the Purva Mimamsakas understand it. That is a technical distinction. That does not mean, it is not that Shruti is superior, Smriti is inferior. That is a preconception some of us have. It's not like that. In fact, when the Smriti is given by a perfect sage, it is more valuable than Shruti. In Tattva Sandarbha, these topics come up. Is the Rig Veda Shruti in English entered in ISKCON as far as I know? No. First of all, the Shruti needs to be understood through the Smriti scriptures. Prabhupada has said the Shruti is so difficult that you need to be exceptionally in the mode of goodness like Lord Brahma to be able to correctly capture the intended meaning. The first 40 mantras of Rig Veda has been explained by Matvacharya on the basis of Vyasadeva's presentation. Vyasadeva's presentation means Smriti. Vyasadeva's Smritis. That it will be useful to have an edition of the based on that standard authentic explanation. So we all have to read and understand. See, the Shruti needs to be understood through the Smriti. Whereas the scriptures are presented in multiple layers. I don't remember if I brought out this concept of Nirnayaka. And then later. There are some scripture. Okay, different scriptures have are related to different. I can say particular scriptures are related to particular other scriptures. There are some scriptures which clarify the meaning of some other scriptures, for instance. Okay, and in that case, the scripture that clarifies is called as Nirnayaka scripture. Clarify that which provides clarity. And Nirnetavya simply means a scripture that provides clarity. In that way, there are layers. The Upanishads are clarified by Bhagavad Gita. Bhagavad Gita is clarified by the Vedanta Sutra. The Vedanta Sutra is clarified by Srimad Bhagavatam. In that way, there are some scriptures which provide clarity, while there are other scriptures which need clarification. So now the Shruti needs to be clarified by the Smriti. When you directly look at the Shruti, you won't understand head or tail out of it. You simply think, what is this? It's just some deva is being called and something. What is going on here? It's not like that. You can't understand the Shruti directly. It's not meant to be understood directly. It's meant to be understood through the Smriti. Academic world, you know, they are foolish. They don't understand. If you want to understand Shastra, there are several protocols you need to follow. Now that you brought it up. Okay, first of all, it's very simple. Ravindra Swarup Prabhu once he said that he's also a member of the academic world. So in one lecture he said he had a meeting with some other academic scholars. And then he said something to this effect that according to the Veda themselves, who can understand the teaching of the Vedas? Yasya deve parabhakti yathare. And when he said it, while he was reciting the verse, a number of scholars, they completed the verse. They all knew it. And he said, this is a method. You need to listen to a guru and from a guru in a parampara and Vedic parampara. And that is the way to learn. The Veda itself says that is the way to study. If you disobey the Veda and you hope to understand the Veda, what are you doing? What are you doing? You cannot understand. So, when you walk in the street and a donkey brays at you, you don't take it seriously. Similarly, when people disobey, and the Veda clearly says, if you don't follow this, you will not understand. You will not understand. But then people don't understand. They may have their own stupid ideas. Have their own crazy ideas. Okay, we're done about that. I'll just give you some idea about various protocols that are required. We'll talk about it. It's in a manuscript, but nevertheless, let me bring it out. This is It's a little bit complicated. This is a conversation. This is from Valmiki Ramayana. And this is actually from Valmiki Ramayana, as it has been explained by a standard commentary from one of the Vaishnava lines. This is the text of Valmiki Ramayana. This is a commentary. You can see the commentary is definitely much larger than the text. So here is something. This is a section where Jatayu is talking to Ravana. Jatayu is going to fight with Ravana. Jatayu is going to die, actually. He says, Nashaktastvam balardhartum vaideki mama pashyataha hetu vir nyaya samyukte dhruvam veda shrutim iva. You cannot forcibly abduct Vaidehi while I bear witness. Just as one cannot usefully misinterpret the Vedic Shruti, which possesses invincible validity by arguments that seem reasonable. So now this is the commentary. This is Govindaraj's commentary. There is an Acharya in the Sri Vaishnava line, Ramanuja Sampradaya, who has commented on the entire Ramayana. This is the only commentary from the four Vaishnava lines that covers every chapter and every canto of the Ramayana. So I have an abridged rendition of that. So this is an abridged rendition of that for that particular verse. Vedic Shruti refers to the self-evident Shruti, which provides knowledge. It does not refer to misinterpretations of the Shruti and so on. This verse implies that when the foremost of learned and enlightened Vedic authorities bears witness, the Shruti cannot be usefully misinterpreted to mean something other than its intended meaning by non-Vedic rationalists using logical arguments. Similarly, in the presence of Jatayu, Sita Devi cannot be carried away from where she wants to be. When one misinterprets the Vedic Shruti, he destroys himself. The Vedic Shruti is not at all injured. Jatayu intends to tell Ravana, by kidnapping Sita, you're the one who will perish. Sita will not be injured at all. Just as the foremost of learned and enlightened Vedic authorities become intolerant of the Vedic Shruti being misinterpreted and prevents it to the best of his ability, I will prevent Sita from being forcibly abducted by you to the best of my ability. So the Veda has its own procedure, its own methodology. I give an idea about that in this manner. Vedic texts have protocols to help the student correctly understand and realize their teachings. One should strive to understand the direct meaning of reliable testimony in the form of the Vedas using the six signs that help one understand the purport of a scriptural text with due consideration of the strength and weaknesses of scriptural statements that appear to conflict with each other. With a correct understanding of which scripture clarifies the teachings of which scripture, practice devotional service unto Lord Vishnu while being continuously absorbed in Vedic knowledge with unbreakable faith in him and in bona fide gurus who are immersed in Vedic knowledge and understanding and who are absorbed in the Supreme Personality of Godhead and who belong to a disciplined succession of Vedic knowledge stemming from Lord Vishnu himself. One's understanding of a scriptural statement should, of course, suit the context. An unambiguous scriptural statement should be used to determine the meaning of ambiguous statements. So now this is, where am I getting these rules from? These rules, actually I'm getting it from Sarva Samvadini to Tattva Sundarbha, that's Jiva Goswami. Purva Mimamsa, which is also referred to by Jiva Goswami. Then I'm gathering it from Madhvacharya's Vishnu Tattva Vidurnaya. Then the Govinda Bhashya, Srimad Bhagavatam, and Sri Jayatirtha in his sub-commentary to Vedanta Sutra. So there are whole procedures. If you don't follow these procedures, you definitely won't understand head or tail of what's going on. And you can imagine whatever you want. Just like small children may take some physics textbook of some university and they may think it's just some garbage nonsense. You can sometimes hear, you know, these small children, 4-year-old, 5-year-old children. Sometimes they go to daddy's room or mommy's room and one of them or both of them might be university professor or something. and they need to play, so they take some drugs. And then someone asks, what is this? Some nonsense and this and that. They might not, whatever, they're like kids. That's what they're taught. So if you're in ignorance, you can imagine whatever you want, but your ignorance is not going to change reality. Okay. Questions? Prem Gosundar Prabhu. Okay, wait, wait, wait. Prem Gosundar Prabhu.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji, Dandavan. Prabhuji, text number 391. I just want to understand the meaning. Even now, if Krishna's beloved devotees develop sufficient eagerness, that ocean of mercy reveals his various pastimes to them. So does he mean that the pastimes will be revealed in their heart, or actually they will see the pastimes in front of their eyes?
Krishna will decide that. Krishna will decide that. Whether it should be shown internally or externally.
Okay, then the next one also, 392. Some exalted devotees overcome by the power of love can see Krishna playing in Vrindavan even today. So these exalted devotees are pure devotees, obviously, right?
Perfect pure devotees.
But then in the commentary, he says pure Vaishnavas could not witness.
Wait, tell me the text number.
392. It appears as if the text and the commentary are contradictory. I mean, I'm not able to.
No, look carefully what he's saying. Your Vaishnavas could not witness Krishna's pastimes unless those pastimes were actual and ongoing.
Yeah, that means they could never witness them in their heart.
They are witnessing, and it would not be possible for them to witness unless those pastimes are actually ongoing.
No, but some exalted devotees overcome by power of can see Krishna playing even today.
That is the whole point. This is a continuation from that. Because they can see, it would not be possible for them to see unless those pastimes are actual and ongoing.
No, but that's what I'm not understanding. I'm getting confused now. You're saying they can see in the heart even today, or even actually physically they can see it today. Depends how Krishna decides.
Okay, they're seeing, no? If the pastimes are not actual and ongoing, how they could see?
They will see in their heart.
Even that cannot happen unless the pastimes are actual and ongoing, no?
Ongoing where? Externally.
Wherever. Is ongoing somewhere.
But they are always ongoing somewhere in the universe. Somewhere
whatever,
in the universe.
But if the pastimes are not ongoing, how can you see something?
I mean, it's up to Krishna to reveal it, you know. Even if it's not going, Krishna
that's
can
okay,
reveal the pastime.
You know, I think you're not even understanding what is the argument of Rupa Goswami.
I have not, that's why I'm asking you. I have not understood.
First of all, you need to understand what his objector's argument is. The person who is opposing Rupa Goswami, what is he thinking? He is saying that these pastimes are not eternal. In fact, most of the Vaishnavas don't even understand the concept of Nityalila. They simply think Krishna came 5,000 years back, did something and went away. And sometime before that, he came as some other form and did something and went away. He keeps coming again, 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 again here. But in the spiritual world, he is only there in his 400 Narayana form. These activities are not constantly going on at all. It's just something he did in the past, that's all. Just for inspiration. So that it could be recorded in the scriptures, which could serve as inspiration. For instance, Ram comes and does various activities which inspire us to become dharmic. Krishna engages in various activities which inspire us to become attracted to devotional service to his lotus feet. Narasimha appears. And he inspires us with courage that if we serve him, he will protect us. But they have no concept that these pastimes are eternal and ongoing and actual. They have no concept of eternal pastimes. In fact, most of the Vaishnavas think like that. Even the non-Vaishnavas think like that. So no sense of eternal pastimes.
So are these 391, 392, is it Purva Paksha or is it Rupa Goswami's argument?
It's Rupa Goswami's own statement, his own, he's pointing out that he's basically saying, if these pastimes are not actual and ongoing, how can those very same pastimes be witnessed now? How can those pastimes be witnessed now if those pastimes are not happening right now?
Mm-hmm.
How can you right now see something which is not happening now? Now, unless you bring in another argument saying, no, but they may be Trikalagya rishis. They may be seeing something from the past or something from the future and like that. But that is, you know, Kalpana Gaurava, that is imagining too much. There's no need to add up your assumptions. The simplest explanation is those pastimes are happening now. And in fact, those exalted devotees also witness these pastimes as they are happening now. They are given access to the current broadcast. It's a live broadcast. It's not pre-recorded. Nor is it some trailer for some future pastime.
Prabhuji, one more small question I have. You said that the Shruti, Shruti Krishna can change the sequence of the words. Right? No, Bhagavad Gita is a Shruti.
No. Smriti.
Okay, but. Okay. Yeah, so my question is that though in Smriti, the sequence of the words can change, but as far as I know, the Bhagavad Gita is based on Upanishads, right? And the Upanishads come from Shruti.
Everything in the Smriti is based on the Shruti. At least the Smriti that Prabhupada is talking about, he's only talking about Smriti that fully follows Shruti. Smriti simply refers to the work of a great sage. Now, all sages are not perfect in spiritual realization. There are some who are imperfect. And they may also compose some works which are partially based on Shruti and partially not. Prabhupada is not talking about such literature as Smriti at all. When he is talking to us about Smriti scriptures, he's only talking about perfect Smriti scriptures, not imperfect literature. Given by some sage. So the Smriti scriptures that he's talking about are Smriti scriptures which 100% follow Shruti scriptures. These are perfect literature. Shruti by definition is perfect, non-defective, nirdosha. That is the technical expression, nirdosha. And we are only talking about nirdosha smritis. We are not talking about sadosha smritis. For instance, we often hear about the six schools of Vedic philosophy, Nyaya Vaisheshika, Sankhya Yoga, Karma Mimamsa, Brahma Mimamsa. So if you look at the first four, their literature were given by some sages, but those literature are defective. You cannot say because these are sages, their writings are to be accepted as Smriti. Even then we will say, even if you want to call it Smriti, we have to point out that these are not nirdosha Smritis. These are not 100% non-defective. These are spotted literature. They're not spotless literature. So we don't, Prabhupada has kept things very simple for us. And he has only referred to the spotless literature from great sages as Smriti. So in that case, Shruti is spotless, Smriti is also spotless. Bhagavad Gita is certainly the essence of the Upanishads. The Upanishads are compared to cows, and Bhagavad Gita is compared to the milk from those cows. All Smriti scriptures, spotless Smriti scriptures, are based on the Shruti scriptures. And texts like Bhagavad Gita deal with the highest portion of Shruti. The highest portion of Shruti are the Upanishads. So Shruti has four portions: Samhita, Brahmana, Samhita, Aranyaka, Upanishads. The Upanishads deal with transcendence, that which is beyond our mundane sense perception, and talk about the importance of liberation and so on. Now, within the Smriti scriptures, now since the Smriti scriptures, they clarify the teaching of Shruti scriptures, just as the Shruti scriptures have certain portions, the Upanishads, which focus on transcendence. Similarly, within the Smriti scriptures also, you have certain portions which focus on transcendence. If you consider the entire Mahabharata, for instance, Mahabharata clarifies the meaning of Shruti itself. But then within Mahabharata itself, there are certain portions which clarify the teachings of the Upanishads. Bhagavad Gita is one such. Moksha Dharma itself, Ramanujacharya said the entire Moksha Dharma section within the 12th canto of Mahabharata, that also clarifies Upanishads. So there are some sections which clarify the Upanishads. Bhagavad Gita is considered to be Gita Upanishad, but not in the technical sense. This distinction that I have brought out here is only a technical distinction.
So that means, Prabhuji, this the Shruti, the sutras of the Upanishad are not repeated as they are in Bhagavad Gita. They are in Krishna's own words. Correct to say that?
Yeah. And apart from that, when Krishna speaks the Bhagavad Gita in the next day of Brahma, don't expect it to have 18 chapters with 700 verses, or the verses will be exactly identical. Smriti. So he, according to the requirement of that time, he may explain it in some other way. Nitya Narasimha Prabhu.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji, Dandavat Pranam Prabhuji. Prabhuji, like now, even the eternal pastimes are happening in Vrindavan now also. So some devotees, they claim that they have seen the Lord. How to, especially Brajavasis, as we seen that only the Lord can reveal to the only exalted devotees. So those who are claiming that they have seen the Lord, so can we understand that they are the exalted Vaishnavas, or how it is? Can you enlighten?
Prabhupada stated that Krishna is the guru of, he is the guru in his dham. So Krishna himself is the guru of the Brajavasis. So when they commit mistakes, he directly punishes them. He disciplines them, he corrects them, he encourages them. Now seeing the Lord's, seeing the Lord is not actually, to be given that much of importance for various reasons. One reason is you may not be actually seeing the Lord. Just as when Lord Chaitanya Mahaprabhu went to Vrindavan, there were some Rajavasis who thought that Krishna was dancing on Kali, whereas in reality something else was happening. Lord Chaitanya was there, Krishna himself, they left him and they went there. That may happen. Apart from that, we will see in Brihad Bhagavatamrita that the demigods, they get to see the Supreme Lord often. If seeing the Supreme Lord itself were to be considered to be a proof of being a pure devotee, then we'll have to say all the demigods are pure devotees, because they keep seeing the Lord all the time. Every now and then, something's wrong, he comes, solves their problem, fixes it up, then he goes away. They come and serve the Lord in various incarnations. And we will see in Brihad Bhagavatamrita that there are four worlds beyond the three worlds. There are three worlds: Bhur, Bhuvah, Swar, up to Indraloka. And beyond Indraloka, They're all the subtle worlds. Janaloka, Tapaloka, Mahaloka, Brahmaloka. And there, in one of those worlds, they do sacrifices all the time. Five sacrifices. Vanaprasthas live there. Soon as they put the sacrificial oblation, immediately the Supreme Lord appears. And he asks, where is my offering? And you give the offering right in his hand. He eats it, he gives it back to you. Every time they do the offering, the Lord himself appears. And then that's a higher realm we will see, where the four Kumaras, the Navayogindras, and the supreme sattvic beings, they reside. As soon as they meditate on the Lord appears in their heart. What to speak of Lord Brahma? For him, Garbhodakshaya Vishnu is his beloved daddy. He plays with Garbhodakshaya Vishnu. Just as a child, sometimes even ridicules his father. Brahma has that kind of relationship with Lord Vishnu. Extremely affectionate relationship. So, seeing, what is to speak of just seeing, you know, seeing by seeing, if you refer to passive seeing, like, you know, like some live streaming. That's one thing. And another thing, interaction. You directly interact with them. The demigods actually interact with him. They interact, you know, he interacts with them in various ways. Demigods and higher beings. Yeah, that is certainly superior to just seeing. But even they are not pure devotees or what to speak of perfect pure devotees. It's not just seeing. I think this is specifically a weakness in India. They think that seeing is, wow, what he saw. Oh, so what? After seeing, what did he do? After seeing, what did he do? So many of our devotees' children, they have seen Krishna, they have seen the deities. The deities come to them, talk to them, help them out in crisis. And so many times it happened. It's not something. Astonishing. And after seeing them, what did he do? Then he went to the pub and boozed and enjoyed with three girlfriends. So, why didn't he take advantage of Krishna's instructions? Of course, later, after many decades, they may lament and, you know, suffer the reactions for having engaged in sinful activities and so on. But, you know, so much of time is wasted. So, it's not just seeing. It involves many more things than that. We are not actually interested in seeing Krishna as such. We are interested in attaining our Swarupa. And Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati underscored this particular point. Prema Pumartho Mahan. The great goal of existence is to attain exclusive loving service to the Supreme Lord. We want to become capable of selfless affection. We want to serve the Supreme Lord and whoever he wants us to serve. Basically, we want to serve the Supreme Lord and his beloved associates. That's what Gaudiya Vaishnavas hanker for. Our goal is to become ourselves. Swarupam Vibhrano Vimala Rasa Bhogam Sakurute Bhaktivinoda Thakur. The final goal is to attain our own Swarupa. But for that, we need to come to the point of pure sadhana bhakti as defined by Rupa Goswami, specifically in Upadeshamrita. It's clarified by Prabhupada in his purports, step by step. And then when we progress one by one, everything will be revealed. Krishna's name, Krishna's form, Krishna's qualities, Krishna's pastimes, Krishna's abode, Krishna's associates, everything. Krishna will reveal everything. It will come. We cannot say that just seeing is not, it's more than that. For instance, if there's a distinction, Vishnu Chakravarti Thakur says in one place, just like if you're not hungry and you're given some good food, you'll not appreciate it. You need to have good hunger and you need to have good food so that selfless affection for Krishna in at least Shantadasya The higher rasas include the lower rasas. So when we talk about higher rasas, they automatically include the essential components of the lower rasas. So it is safe to say that you must have Shanta Dasya. Shanta means you have no desire for anything other than Krishna. You're only interested in Krishna. Dasya means you want to use your spiritual senses in order to serve Krishna's spiritual senses. So at the very least, one must have Shanta Dasya uninterruptedly. And that is equivalent to having good hunger, good appetite. Then when you are allowed to interact with Krishna directly, then it is very satisfying both to Krishna and to us.
Very good. Thank you very much, Prabhu. Very nicely.
Okay. Anything else? If there are no questions, I'll stop. If you have questions, you can ask in the Telegram group. All right. Anshaka Patra Vyashar, Parsing Vyashar, 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 Vy